like rock and roll.
You like music? That's what I think. Yeah, well, that's good. I like it too. That's why I play in a group called You Too. Yeah, you haven't heard of it. Okay. You will. That's why we're here.
In the late 70s, U2 was emerging as a hot underground band in the Irish rock scene. The group, made up of Bono, The Edge, Adam Clayton, and Larry Mullen Jr., was growing frustrated with their small-time notoriety. U2 was prominent in Ireland, but they felt limited by their label independence. After being passed on by dozens of record companies, the band's manager Paul McGuinness got U2 signed to Island Records in March of 1980. After a performance by the band at the Lyceum in Dublin, McGuinness introduced them to Nick Stewart of Island to sign their record deal. It was in the ladies' bathroom of this venue that they signed their first recording contract, as it was the only place in the theater with adequate lighting. With that, U2 began their inexorable march to becoming one of the biggest bands on the planet. Quick to record their first album, U2 started looking for a producer. Martin Hannett of Joy Division fame was the band's partner for their first single on Island Records, 11 O'Clock Tick Tock. Upon their first sessions, Hannett quickly realized how inexperienced the members of U2 were. None of them knew basic recording terms, having to explain to them what words like overdub meant. Larry Mullen Jr. refused to use a click track despite Hannett's protests. As a result, the backing track is slightly out of time for the whole song. The song's snare drum was put through a time modulator effect to put Hannett's signature sound on it. Once the day was over, he was careful to turn all the settings in the booth back to zero so the engineer couldn't see what he'd done. After the first single, U2 tried to reunite with the producer to continue with their album. However, in May of 1980, lead singer of Joy Division Ian Curtis committed suicide. In a depressed state, Hannett canceled his plans with U2 at the last minute, leaving them without a producer and without a clear vision for the future. Shortly afterward, post-punk producer Steve Lillywhite received a copy of the EP U2 3 in the mail from Island Records. After listening to the songs, Lillywhite was convinced he needed to work with U2. The members of U2 were in agreement that they had found their producer. The band turned to Windmill Lane Studios in Dublin in July of 1980 to work on their new songs. Lillywhite brought an experimental side out of U2, encouraging them to explore new sounds. As a result, they brought bikes into the studio and started turning them over, finding forks in the kitchen and playing them on the wheels as percussion. Drums were recorded in a tall stairwell with microphones lining the storage from top to bottom. This experimentation is also how the glass bottle sound effects ended up on the album's opening track, I Will Follow. Like many of the band's songs, the lyrics of I Will Follow have many different meanings, ranging from a conversation with God to Bono lamenting about the death of his mother Iris, who passed away when he was only 14. The lyrics, "Your eyes make a circle," are a double entendre about gazing at someone while also alluding to his mother's name. This theme follows in the next track, Twilight, with the lyrics, "In the shadow, boy meets man." In the shadow, boy meets man. In this line, Bono details how unexpected tragedy early in life can force someone to grow up faster than they expected to. Out of Control was one of U2's most popular songs while touring in Ireland and prior to the release of the album. It was their first single released with CBS Ireland before the band signed with Island Records. The song details the story of the beginning of Bono's life, starting with his 18th birthday. He calls the song a birthday song, which is why the lyrics continue with Bono singing about the day he was born. Even as a young band, the lyrics of U2's songs often centered on heavy subject matters, like coming to grips with the inevitability of death. The title of the song comes from Bono's realization that not only is his life out of control, but the end of his life will be too. The last track on the album, Shadows in Tall Trees, borrows its name from the title of a chapter of William Golding's Lord of the Flies. The track is meant to mirror the themes of the book, about boyhood, the inherent violence in everyone, and the struggle of innocence.
Because we all have the violence in ourselves, we all have the ability to kick the cat, and if not kick the cat, it's a mental violence.
After just over a month, U2 had finished the record, and on October 20th, 1980, U2 released their debut album, Boy.
Why'd you call the album Boy? Why not Girl, Child?
I think it's a symbol of innocence. It's a symbol of a beginning, you know.
And it's just an introduction to U2. It's a starting off point.
The boy on the band's album cover is Peter Rowan, the brother of one of Bono's friends who grew up across the street from him. The members of U2 had an idea of how the album cover was going to look, a boy's face coming out of white as if it's a photograph still in the process of developing, a metaphor for leaving boyhood. The album was about youth and inexperience, as evidenced by the album's title and cover. Across the ocean in the United States, the album had gained a considerable following in the gay community. As a result, Island changed the album cover for American release to be an abstract, distorted photo of the band's four members, out of fear that the album would be misconstrued as advocating for pedophilia.
The Americans have banned the cover of the album. The album was released last week in the US. We're going out there.
Bono and the Edge were particularly dismayed by this, and maintained that the original album cover is superior. Boy helped U2 emerge on the scene, selling almost 200,000 copies of the original album. The single I Will Follow had become a hit on college radio in the US. Reviews were favorable, and the band began to make their mark both in print and on TV. In the UK, the album peaked at number 52 on the charts, while in the US, Boy reached number 63 on the Billboard 200 and was certified platinum by the RIAA. Recording the album was only a short break from touring for U2, as they had been playing shows consistently since 1978. The band manager Paul McGuinness subscribed to the ideal that the band should exclusively be playing sold-out shows. Because of this, U2 always played shows that were slightly too small for them for years. Due to their small repertoire of songs to pull from, the band usually had a very short set, both beginning and ending the show with 11 o'clock TikTok and I Will Follow. With the success of Boy, so followed the success of their live shows. Shortly after the first single was released, U2 played a show each week for 4 weeks at the Marquee Club in London. The first week, the show was half full. The next show, it was entirely full. The third show had a line around the block, and by their last show, the entire street was blocked off for U2's performance.
Success might spoil you too.
I hope it does.
The band was satisfied with their popularity in Europe for now, and set their sights on expanding their reputation abroad. While trying to break into America, manager Paul McGuinness sought help from one of the country's biggest agents, Frank Barcelona. They made a deal where Frank would help U2 play popular clubs like Paradise in Boston to grow their following in the country. In return, the promoters would keep the band as they rose through the ranks over the years. This continued for a decade afterward.
May I introduce to you two of the gentlemen from U2? This is Bono, and this man calls himself The Edge. All right, way they go. Edge. All right.
After months of touring, U2 had finally found some sort of notoriety in the United States, playing on TV programs and strong club shows. However, this success happened very suddenly, and the band grappled to maintain their camaraderie through what they perceived as mediocre live shows. Oftentimes, fight would break out both on and backstage, with one of them culminating with Bono throwing Larry's drum kit into the audience. At one show in Europe, Bono took a high jump off of a PA stack, and once he reached the ground, the audience was laughing at him. He eventually came to realize that his pants had ripped open on the way down from the speakers. The audience was full of press, record company associates, and other members of the music business. Bono was so mad that he launched into a tirade, yelling,
"I got some shows I can look like you! So I can look like you!"
He had completely lost his cool, and this was an analogy for the band not feeling like they were identifying with the European rock scene at the time. They were trying to fit in, but they never got the reaction that they wanted.
This is to get attention!
This started a theme at U2 live shows, where Bono would get keyed up at the audience to keep them on edge. The band largely agreed that the only way to deal with Bono's onstage antics was to run for your life, but also agreed that it was all part of his job as the frontman to make a name for U2 with his behavior and personality.
But when it comes down to it, really just in it for the tea. Yeah, I think so.
Ladies and gentlemen, what can I say about these august men, these titans among rock and rollers? Mine and yours, the band for the future, the 80s or 90s, who knows, U2.
U2 continued propelling forward in both the US and UK, gathering a strong, if modest, international following. After their debut album, U2 had their sights set forward, wanting to grow as a band and in recognition. Little did they know just how big they would become.
Judging by what people have written about these fellas in Newsweek magazine and some of the music publications, we will be hearing a great deal of the U2 in this country in the months and years to come. Congratulations.